Someone once said to me, if you really want to put on weight, what you've got to do is drink milk. Lots of milk. 8 pints of milk a day, apparently. That's the case. I did it for a fortnight. 8 pints of milk a day, count them up at the end of the first week, that's 56 pints of milk, all right? End of that first week, I had udders. End of the fortnight, whenever it rained, I would lie down. Horrible. And then I went into the health and fitness muscle emporium place, all right, and I bought some of this concentrated bulko foodo proteino stuff, right? I don't know what it is. It's sort of bulko foodobo. I don't know. It's 8,000 calories in a packet, but you can't eat it. It's rancid. No, I just used to get like half a dozen packets, strap them to my body and put my jacket on. I mean, I don't want to be a fatty, all right? I mean, because I don't want to get into that gluttony thing, right, being a glutton, because that is a sin. You know, gluttony is definitely a sin. Oh, yes, that's capital sin number 5, that one. Thou shalt not take a size 18. That's what, oh, yes, but despite that, despite the fact that it's a sin, there are all these fat people going about this world who've got the cheap... Beg your pardon. There are all these big-boned people going about this world and they've got the cheek to be jolly. How can they be jolly? Don't they know they're damned? They're committing a mortal sin, these people. Well, they'll find out on Judgment Day. They'll find out there is no room for fatties in heaven. No, no. Because they'll be up at heaven and we'll be at the back of the queue, these people at Heaven's Gate. They'll be at the back of the queue sweating and perspiring and worrying. Because up at the front of the queue, Peter will be standing and he'll have a book in one hand and a set of bathroom scales in the other. I'll be searching them for pies and cakes and all that. Try to smuggle in a pack of hobnobs, man, you get sent to the fat people's purgatory. Which is a kind of it's like an eternal step Reebok, yes? Don't want to fall in a fiery chasm, lose that excess ectoplasm. What the hell, Peter? Hey. Peter, there's another curry shop about here anywhere. Jesus Christ. But how can that be so evil? How can that be a sin, just stuffing your face? I mean, surely food's not that evil. Although when you think about it, I mean, whenever you see a picture of the devil, what's he got in his right hand? A big fuck. He's probably got a plate the size of a paddling pool. How can that be so evil? I mean, I have the feeling that perhaps what it is it's excess is maybe the sin. Maybe that's where the vice is, all right? No, I'm not into excess. No, no, no. I'm into moderation. In a big way. Except when it comes to my vices, like smoking. Unfortunately, I smoke. Now, I've cut down. I'm down to one at a time now. And it's antisocial. It's a bummer for all the people around about me. I know that. But I do think it's a bit thick that smoking gets such a bad rep when drinking is almost condoned. Now, I'm not saying here that two wrongs make a right, but I am saying that I have never seen men and women shouting and singing sectarian songs in the street because of it, a few too many Embassy Regals. No, and I know that your lungs don't get harmed by the fumes of a drunk, but your box gets done in by the amount of shite they talk. You don't hear about the dangers of that, do you? The secondary shite? No. No. And I know this. I know if you were to take, say, if you take an alcoholic's brain and you were to dissect it right down the middle, you'll find that one half is like cheese. It's pickled. It's addled in vodka. But the other half is bright, razor-sharp, clean, devious, sly, one step ahead of everyone else, in one respect at least. So that, for instance, you could lock an alcoholic in a room over here. You know, you could do it, no key, you just lock that door, take away the key, don't give them a phone, no window, no means of escape, keeping them in there. You go away for half an hour, you come back, you open the door, they're sitting with a bottle of white in Mackay. Hey, presto! Magicians must feel like chucking it when they see your average alky in action. How does you manage that, says Paul Daniels. Whoa, I cannot divulge myself. I'll be thrown out of a methylated circle. However, for my next trick, mindless abuse and lies. I take one ordinary family, I tie them up in knots, disappoint them 100 times, and hey, presto, they disappear. So, anyway, nothing would do her, but she had to have this couch. On this occasion, a particularly expensive couch. Now, we had been up and down a town a whole day long viewing couches. We'd been to Habitat, to Fraser's, the East End Couch Emporium. I was fed up. My feet were loud and I just wanted to go home and watch Pingu the Penguin. I was just tired. I was fed up. All right. I'd been in a day-long state of mental agitation at the thought of parting with money. On this occasion, quite a lot of money. Because the couch which my loved one had her heart set on cost £1,500. £1,500. Well, granted, it was a nice couch. Oh, yes, very nice indeed. Great big three-seater affair over here, you know. Lovely Laura Ashley print on there. Some oak stuff hanging off the sides of it there. Three great big flumpy old cushions all stuffed with down. I don't know what that is. It's a feather's off a duck, all right. For, I mean, £1,500, man, I want real ducks, you know? Ho, ho! I want a conversation piece for that money. I want people saying, hold on, Marty, have you got ducks in that couch? I certainly have, £1,500. You can get eggs out of that couch. Let me start having this ferocious argument in the street, all right, about whether or not we're going to get this thing. Now, she said to me, to justify the expenditure, you know one of the arguments she used? It'll last us a long time. I said, oh really? So would a brick, right? Because I'm really sharp on arguments. I was witty on a case that morning. So would a brick, I said. And I thought, that will be her, shattered. And sure enough, she was speechless. I think she was just astonished at stupidity. So would a brick, what? And I said, I feel good. I thought, well, that brick comment worked there. And I said, oh, by the way, I said, you know, what about the cat? What about the cat? I said, we could spend all this money, get this couch installed up at the house there. Your cat is going to come walking in like this. Wow! Yes! Wow! I said, the cat will tear that couch to shreds, man. Try to get into the ducts, man. The ducts are there somewhere. The cat will tear it up, I said. And you'll have noticed that, of course, I'm making that point there, the cat had become her cat, okay? I said, and I'm feeling good in the fight, but this time some people will stop like that. Oh, hold on, look at this, look, you've got a laugh here, look at these two. Oh, wait, did you hear that man about a brick? Whoa. So I said, by the way, how much did the cat cost? How much did your cat cost us to buy? She said, it cost us nothing in Finewell, you know, Finewell, we rescued it being destroyed, and it cost us a bloody penny. Good point. Perhaps a referee might have given her that round, but I think the ringside judges would have still given it to Morty, because I think the ringside judges would have said, well, Morton's going good in the fight so far. He's using a classic Czechoslovakian counter-attack here. They were arguing about a couch, and now they're arguing about a cat. Bing! And back into the fight. The cat's now the innocent pawn in a power struggle, okay? And I'm really wiring now. I said, the cat may not cost us a penny to buy it, but what about the maintenance? I said, we're spending what? How much a week? We're buying cat food, cat milk, then Poncy wee cat biscuits, you know, them wee Go Crunch cat biscuit things. Oh, Poncy, what? Very nice with a couple of Horlicks, but oh, just... I mean, I said, I cat witter, we're spending £15 a week on gravel, all right? And by this time, I'm really waiting in a crowd. I'm going, oh, 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 oh. And I'm feeling good in a fight, but this time slapping away a few, okay? And maybe it was the crowd that distracted me, maybe something caught my eye, because when I looked back, she came forward with a roaster. I didn't see it coming. It was a sucker punch, but she delivered it well. She said, oh, by the way, she said, how much do you spend a week on fags? Boom, pow! Right, I go, got no defense against that one. Ow, and she comes off the rope, she's feeling good. She says, and what about a computer game? She said, 30 quid a shot to blow up aliens, you maniacs. Ha, bang, bang, pow, I go back. What about your bowling? She said, I said, the bowling's only £4 a week. She said, you go twice a week, I believe that's £8. All right, plus the hire of your shoes, 75 pence, plus the beer you buy when you get there, plus the taxi when you're going home, because by the time you're finished bowling, you're too steaming away on a bus. Pow, 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 and I'm going back, pow, pow. And then she came forward, the killer punch, the coup de grace, she just administered it. She went, oh, by the way, she said, don't think I've forgotten about the couch. Boom, pow. So, we compromised. We bought the couch. But, we bought it on HP. That means it's costing us £1,800. All right, I know mathematicians may correct me, but we had that £600 per cushion. And that's why I charge people when I come into my house. I give them tickets at the door. I say, that'll be £1, you can sit there for an hour. All right, after a while I go, number two, your time is up, sit on a carpet. Well, apparently we only need another 1,000 visitors and the couch is ours by the end of the year. But how about that? Two human adults that love one another, shouting like maniacs in the street, and it was money that done it. But I'm not too surprised. I mean, I've seen it start. I've seen it real young, you know, avarice. I've seen that glint in the eyes of kids. I mean, a few years ago, I'm working in a department store over Christmas. I'm working as a Santa Claus, all right? I've got, waiting for a bit of extra money, so I get the red coat, you know, the boots, the white beard. I'm in a grotto with a plastic reindeer. All the kids are coming in, asking me for a Christmas present, talk to Santa. I'm like, yeah, oh, this, right? Until eventually I could take no more. One day I just snapped. There's a wee boy sitting on my knee. He's going, yeah, I want this, I want that. I just went, yo, buy the baby, man. I don't exist. Don't get me wrong, I got nothing against kids, all right. Nothing. God bless them, God bless them. They do a lot of work for charity, God bless them. I just don't particularly want to have any. I mean, I probably could if I wanted, you know, dozens probably. I just don't want to have any. And I know people say to me, hey, Marty, the thing about kids is, it's different when you've got your own. Well, so's a verruca. You know? I just want to make it clear there, though. Make it crystal clear. I got nothing against kids. Wouldn't do them any harm. Because if I don't make that clear, I could end up with Esther Ranson coming up to my door. You know what I mean? What's your problem, Martin? You a pervert or something? You hate kids? What are you, a problem? Going to do an expose on you? I'll say, Esther, baby, sorry. Wait, just come in. Sorry, relax. Sit down. Sorry, let me explain. Sit down. That'll be £1.
Mm-hmm.